hell is that? Now it looks like some kind of gory Hershey's Kiss. Now that the cyst has disgorged its prisoner, the husk looks hollow, deflated, defeated. Examine the remains. It's an object. Mesmeric handle. Something catches your eye. It's a piece of sharp metal that protrudes from just underneath a fold of decaying bloom flesh. You cannot begin to guess at its function, but it's small and easy to carry. You slip it into your pouch. What was this? Quest item artifact. You found this object inside a ruptured bloom cyst. It is made of azure steel and resembles the hilt of a small knife, but the blade is missing. Oh! Do you have to find the blade?
I'll remember that.
A hilt without a blade. Reminds me of the Pillars of Eternity quest. We find the sword and the hilt. We have to find two or three pieces of the sword. And then we ended up with this freaking awesome sword that Adair had for the rest of the game, because it was pretty awesome. So our natural lore tells us that the creature within the cyst was an abacos. Wait, we've seen them. That one looked a little different, though. A being that feeds on transdimensional energies. Assuming that it was in the cyst for any length of time, it must have been surviving by draining energy from the object you just found. A closer examination of the object should tell you more. Examine the remains again, just in case. Now that you've claimed the object the creature left, the cavity is utterly empty. So what the hell do we have here? We can use it. The device resembles the hilt of a weapon. It rests easily in your hand, but there is no blade. Inspect.
Updated my journal.
The device is made of azure steel. It appears to be inert and has no obvious function. A stylized name is inscribed into the steel. I-O-X-U. Ioxu? Laxu? Behind a strong glass plate, you find a compartment that contains an old, depleted power core. It's blackened and drained, so you toss it aside. You could place another power source inside the compartment, but it may require a particular type of energy.
I'll remember that.
So my mystical lore tells me that based on your understanding of the technology, it seems as though the device would require a transdimensional power source, something that harnesses the energy of singularities of parallel or parallel universes, which makes sense because the abacos feeds on the transdimensional power, so it has drained this now. Okay, let's look at what we have in Codex, and then Journals. So we have... we have Bloom Guide. I don't think we have... oh, Bloom Guides, yeah. Some people claim to know the ways of the Bloom. They've learned its tubes and byways, explored its stinking slums, and discovered what its maws like to eat. Some even say that the Bloom favors them, opening passageways to take them where they want to go. Such people often hire themselves out as Bloom Guides, earning money by providing advice and direction to merchants and explorers. Their careers rarely last long, of course. The Bloom's favor is almost always short-lived. Doesn't seem like a kind of life I'd want to leave, that's for sure. The vast interior. The vast interior is a cavernous void in the midst of the bloom. Bony platforms cling to the walls or sit atop columns of flesh and gristle. Walkways connect these platforms, crafted by humans, using whatever unpleasant materials are close at hand, suspended above the bloom's cavernous depths. Some platforms hold shrines, shops, or homes, including the Shrine of Great Chilla. There's the abacos. Seen that before. It has never been defeated. Oh, now it has. Oh, journal. Updated my journal. Alright, go to the trade post. Drakogen told me to follow the caravan route from the Memravira's courtyard to the trade post. That's where I'll find a maw that will take me to the Ascension. The trade post has been devoured by the bloom, so I can't get there from the vast interior. According to Grissler, a bloom guide, the trade post is probably still intact, but I'll have to find another way to reach it. My only recourse is to try opening various maws and hope that one of them leads to the trade post. A hilt without a blade. Inside a fleshy cyst, I've found a device that resembles a hilt. It seems to be technological in nature, so perhaps there is a way to reactivate the blade. Examine. If I examine the device I found in the cyst, I might learn how it works. I did. The hilt doesn't appear to be damaged. It just needs a fully charged power source in order to function. I found a name, Iaxu, inscribed onto the surface of the hilt. The device requires a transdimensional power source, something that harnesses the energy. I can't talk, man. Something that harnesses the energy of singularities or parallel universes. Tybeer. And little Nylesh. Oh, that's where that is. Still need to do that. We need to find attractive people or something. I might lose, like, gold tied for doing that. Find the missing patrols. Find help for Aratus in the Chiogen slump. That'll help him there. Telny and Vrung. Okay. Continuing.
Fair enough.
Sundermun the Younger. Oh, and the Elder. And this goes to Chiogen slump. So we can get everywhere but the trader's post. We'll start with the older one. Near a display of goods that appear to have been made of bloom flesh, either tanned, beaten, carved, or cured, stands an old man who looks fairly tanned, beaten, carved, and cured himself. He also has startling yellow eyes. "Hello," he exclaimed, admiring my stock. "You won't find anything else like it, not even here in the bloom. All handcrafted and one of a kind." I have some questions for you. Who wouldn't when confronted with such unusual merchandise? Ask away. What exactly do you sell here? Bloom flesh, my friend. Bloom flesh. We craft everything out of it. Clothing, armor, building materials, jerky, you name it. Ugh. The bloom cultists in particular love wrapping themselves in bloom flesh. But everybody buys from us, even the Murdens. You might say our business is blooming. He raises his eyebrows at you expectantly. Ha! His apprentice laughs, Sunderman the Younger. Good one, Sunderman. Thanks, Sunderman, says the older merchant. I liked it myself when I first heard it. We craft unique specialty items from bloom flesh as well as more mundane items such as clothing and building materials. What do you know about the bloom cultists? Got some odd notions, those folk. They worship the bloom as a deity and aren't afraid of being eaten. He shrugs. Crazy, of course, but they're my best customers, so I just smile and nod whenever they natter on about it. I've said all there is to say. They're good customers, and while their beliefs aren't mine, they do me no harm. If you want to know more, just ask them. Last I saw, a few of them are hanging around Iaxu's shop. That's his blade. Or was. Iaxu's shop. What do you think of the Murdens? He grimaces. Those hunchback beak faces will steal anything they can get their claws on. We sell clothes to them, and because of that they mostly let us be, but I trust them as far as I can throw them, and I'd advise you to do likewise. Steer clear of them. That's the best advice I can give you when it comes to Murdens. Can I ask you about that cyst at the edge of the platform? He regards you with a squint. Whatever was in there was probably pretty dangerous, and now it's out, thanks to a certain someone who thought they knew better than the bloom. The one you opened, allowing that horrible creature to escape? No, I'd rather not even think about it. Okay. What do you have for sale? Just a few things. He's got bloom flesh armor. Of course, everything's going to be made out of bloom flesh, right? 7 armor, 5 resistance. Ooh, minus 3 to might and speed, and minus 50% on esoteric attacks. Not good. At the start of each turn, a tentacle latches onto a nearby enemy. Does 6 trans-dimensional damage to the target. Heals 6 points of health on the wearer, like a vampiric thing. Only usable by the last cast-off. Fashioned from the flesh of the bloom, this armor is very much alive. It is, perhaps, the Elder Sunderman's masterwork. The thick flesh offers excellent physical protection, while its trans-dimensional nature protects the wearer against more exotic attacks. In the center of the chest is a tiny maw, though you're not sure where it leads. The living flesh is tough and resistant to manipulation, making the armor difficult to put on. However, once it is worn for a time, it shapes itself to your form, becoming as familiar as your own skin. The sensation is comforting, even if the notion is not. Now, we do not have nearly enough money for this thing. We also have a bloom bone shard. It's a light melee weapon. See, this might be good for us, actually. Can I do a compare? Serve the infused crystal. 3 physical damage, that's the same. Only the bloom bone shard has 4 chemical damage. And then plus 3 damage per effort applied. Max plus 15. Same, but the max is higher. Of course we got the light weapon bonus. And on critical hits, confer controlled. Forced to act on the caster side for 1 round. Critical hit, though. I don't attack very much physically. So I might just save my money. Yeah, I'm going to save my money. The blade of this dagger was harvested from one of the bloom's teeth, fashioned into a crude-looking but effective weapon. A fragment of the bloom's mind still persists inside the shard. In addition to its slashing damage, it can also penetrate the mind of your opponent, lessening prowess in combat. When you hold it to your ear, you hear odd, disturbing whispers from the bloom, sending an involuntary shudder through your spine. We've also got a blood globe. What the hell? Also probably not buying this. Deals 24 mental damage, confers demoralize to all creatures in range of the target point, which is minus 20% willpower, minus 10% evasion, and minus 15% on all tasks. Active entire crisis. This glass globe holds a viscous cocktail of pulsating pink and purple auras, muddied by folding layers of putrid decay. This foul brew was harvested from somewhere in the depths of the bloom. Tormented, haunting whispers of the bloom's digested victims still trickle from the object. If the globe was hurled, the sludge would spatter everyone in a small radius. Any creature struck by the sludge would experience the same mental torments as the hapless victims of the bloom, whose dissipating minds are still contained in the syrupy muck. Yep, passing that up too. We have refined Fleetfoot Moss, we've seen 6 points of speed. And, oh, I don't have enough money for this either. Metabolism Flesh Bud. It's a bonded artifact. Plus 1 speed image. What? Plus 1 speed edge and plus 1 damage per effort applied, max plus 6. Negative effects are minus 2 speed pool. A pass. This pod-like lump of bloom flesh has the shape and size of a small hemispherical bit of fruit. That is where the similarities end, as the flesh bud is quivering and still very much alive. A mangle of teeth and tongue-like protrusions appear on one side whenever the lump is anywhere close to living flesh. When applied to bare skin, the flesh bud bites and grabs itself to the host, taking on the texture and appearance of the host's skin. Once attached, it vastly improves the metabolic processes of the host, increasing quick reaction speed. I might have seen this thing back in Sega's Cliffs, not sure. Seems vaguely familiar. Alright, well thanks, I'm going to pass on all that stuff. What about the younger? Oh, where is he?
Don't mind if I do.
He's right there. Sunderman the Younger. This friendly-looking youth is dripping strips of cured bloom flesh into colored dye. He looks up as you approach, revealing startling yellow eyes, just like those of his employer. Hello, madam. Are you interested in our wares? They're handcrafted and one of a kind. You look an awful lot like your employer. Are you related? Heh, you notice that? Well, you should talk to him. He gets a kick out of telling people about it. He thinks, I admit, I like seeing the look on people's faces when he does. What sort of work are you doing? I'm Sunderman's apprentice. That means I do whatever he tells me, really. Mostly harvesting usable bloom flesh. It's always an adventure, flesh harvesting, though my elder tells me I'll be going away on a bigger adventure soon. He grins cheerfully. Can't wait. Is he gonna feed you to a maw? Like I said before, I do whatever Sunderman tells me. Cutting and preparing the bloom flesh, dyeing it, and harvesting more flesh when we need it. What do you sell here? You'll probably be interested in the specialty items and armor we craft from the bloom flesh, but we also sell everyday stuff like clothes and building supplies. Everyone buys from us, even those... he shivers. Those Murdens. Talk to my elder if you want to buy anything. Isn't it dangerous to harvest bloom flesh? Not really. People only fear the bloom when they don't understand it. He puffs off his chest. I've lived here all my life, and nothing's ever happened to me. Oh, but it will, youngster, chuckles the old merchant who stands beside the apprentice. It will. The younger man laughs uncomfortably. You keep saying that, but you won't say when. If I did, says the older man, you might try to avoid it. He thinks, I know I would, if only to see what happens. Seems like you know the bloom pretty well. Are there any moths nearby? I know of one for sure, in Chirurgeon Slump. Been there a really long time. I hear there's one in the old slave block, too, but I don't go in there because of the Murdens, so I can't be sure. There's one in Chirurgeon Slump that's been around for a long time, and maybe another in the old slave block, but I've not laid eyes upon it myself. Great, you should talk to my elder. He handles the actual trading. So long. Okay, so we get to ask him about why they look the same. Back for more, I see. Who could blame you? All our products are crafted from the most unique bloom flesh we can find. Ask away. I couldn't help but notice that you and your apprentice look very much alike. Well spotted, well spotted. He grins widely, a twinkle in his eye. And why would you speculate that is, madam? He thinks, ah, I love telling the story. She'll never guess. Okay, not his son. I think, like a clone. Or a younger version of himself ripped from time, I'm thinking. Hmm. Even time is not simple in this world. I think he is you. Blue tie, tiny amount. Ha! Well done! He claps you on the back. Not many people managed to figure that one out. Let me tell you what happened. Or will happen, if you like. He thinks, actually that Aeon priest in the slump saw it too. Is it somehow more obvious than it used to be? One day soon, my younger self will be walking along when the bloom will open a maw beneath him, and he'll tumble into another world, years in the past. Or maybe the journey to the past will be when he tries to come back. Whatever the case, it'll take him many decades and worlds to travel back here. He smiles wistfully. I envy him the experiences he will have, but thank him for the memories. It sounds like a dangerous journey. Shouldn't you warn yourself? I did, but I didn't listen. He smiles affectionately at his younger self. Besides, when I think about all the stories I've filled my head with, it's hard to remember exactly what I said about when the big day is. He leans in close and whispers, "But it's coming soon." Doesn't knowing what will happen change the future? He frowns, puzzled. Why? I knew it was coming, but it hasn't changed my past. Tell me of some of these memories or experiences you had and will have. He looks over at his younger self, who is assiduously not listening. He He laughs a little and speaks softly. My first journey was to a desert world where the natives looked like humanoid spiders. It's the best way I know to describe them. They spoke with their minds in a combination of colors that danced between their fingers. It was difficult to get them to understand me, but we managed to find a way. I'm lucky they didn't eat me. When I'd gained their trust, I worked with them as a guide and hunter. I'd flush their prey and they'd snare it with great chemical lattices. But one was always looking at me like he wanted to get a taste of me, and one day he made a move. I ran and found the bloom's maw still open, but time bent and it came back in the past. He looks at his young self. The one you want to watch for is Gil Riddle. Well, when I got back to our world, I didn't know it was the past, right? But no one I knew was alive yet. I went home and met my parents at the age my young self is now. I realized I needed to light out and get my feet under me, because I've never been enough of an idiot to ignore good advice from my older self. He and his younger self laugh at this. I set my heart on reaching the Steadfast. When I came on her, she was... Sundermun the younger says, wait, why'd you stop talking?
I'll remember that.
Preservation of beauty. He laughs ruefully. Oh, we have someone to give to the thing. The android thing. I forget the name. He laughs ruefully, because I remember how frustrated I was when the old man wouldn't tell me about the beautiful woman he met. But let me tell you this. She was tall and dark, with eyes that dropped away into eternity. Her voice was the sweetest music, and when she spoke I had to concentrate to get her meaning, because otherwise I'd drift away on the song. Her form was a delight, and we shared a time that... He breaks off again, blushing. It was the best time of my life. Tell me more. Blue Tide. Not boring your ears off yet, eh? Heh, fine. We spent glorious years together, she and I, but as time went on, I aged, and she stayed radiant. She was an augur, see? Long-lived and wise. Eventually I told her I had to return to the bloom to teach myself how to live, and that it'd be years before I could make it back to her, and I'd be old when I got back. She didn't care, she said. She'd find a way to make me young again, and to grant me the span her kind takes for granted. When the boy here heads off on our adventure, why, then I'll go west again and find her. Blue Tide is for asking, because I want to know, right? Knowledge and stuff. He laughs. That's all the stories I can tell you. Right about here is where I tell you that I need to save some surprises for my young self. Sometimes this time stream seems to make things especially easy. Come back soon. Preservation of beauty. Sundermun the Elder told me about a beautiful woman he met on his journey. I wonder if the Decanted would be interested in recruiting someone from far away. Should I even do that? Seems wrong. Alright. Walks without fear. Hail walks without fear.
Why
you,
not?
You ghostly thing, you. I would have words with thee. At first you're not sure if your eyes are playing tricks on you. A semi-transparent man shuffles and struts before you, his body fading into and out of incorporeality. His once fine clothes have rotted away, his long beard looks to be host to any number of small vermin, and his eye sockets are disturbingly empty. Yet as you draw near, somehow he hones in directly on your face, and you have the unnerving feeling that he can see more than what's on the surface. The staring sockets are deep and cavernous, as if they contain depths and space beyond the confines of his skull. He says nothing to you. Who are you? His sockets stare into you for a moment while he considers. At last he shakes his head and says, I do not know. I have language, and I have the memory of muscles, but I do not remember how I came by these truths. But what I remember is, waking in the depths of the bloom, I remember walking. I remember years of darkness before I emerged into the upper reaches at last. He thinks, the bloom took something. Took me, but gave me peace in its place. I cannot remember. What happened to you? The bloom took my old life from me. I woke in its beating heart and gestated there while it digested my memories. I remember being terrified, but I do not remember what terrified means. He shakes his head to clear it. I had a name. I had a body. I had emotion and a life outside this form, but I do not remember any of those things now. I do not remember fear. I am reborn in a new life. I am free. So that's what the Maw took? His whole body? And left his soul behind, but... and all his emotions? What are you doing here? I walk through this larger part of me and let it guide my steps. The weapons of humans mean nothing to this shape, and the paths of the bloom open for me. I am a part of the bloom. It is a part of me. I have been to places others have never seen, and I have seen worlds that lie waiting beyond the Maws. I am speaking to you. The past is gone, devoured by hungry time. So he can tell us a lot about the bloom and maybe where Maws are and stuff. You came from the depths of the bloom? What did you see down there? If I speak of them, the memories disappear from me forever. Yet thoughts themselves are ephemera, like our lives, gone, and only those we chose to share have any hope of continuation. But even that memory is vanity. In a generation, who will remember these words? His socketless eyes look away, and then back again. He smiles gently. Let me tell you what I saw. He thinks, my memories are useless. Perhaps telling you will increase their life. The bloom reaches through dimensions and across realities. What did I see? I saw a vast beating heart. I traveled through skeins of the bloom's arteries and its viscera. I stood in open maws and looked out across alien landscapes where lost sailors mourn for home, or crystal fields glitter under distant stars. I walked through the slave block where the great Chilla staged her revolution. What would you know? Oh my. Tell me of the heart. A vast beating heart. A great chamber, the place where the bloom spawns and devours its voices, where its whispers gather in conclave, where its intelligence is strongest and sharpest. I woke. Woke? There. And I knew it from my master. He thinks dangerous. Not to me, not anymore. But so, so hungry. I no longer remember. Ephemeral are memories. Once told, they are forever forgotten. Huh? Tell me of the bloom's viscera, whatever. The gullet. That is its name among the bloom guides. A place of veins and flesh where the memories of the bloom's chosen, where they are digested. Echoes wander the place. Echoes of the eaten. He holds a hand to his head as if pained. I recall stories of the abyss, the gates of Abaddon. The gullet could be their sauce, their source. The gullet. The memories are digested. Echoes of the eaten wander it. He's not gonna remember. Yep. Tell me about the sailors. Lascars, they call themselves, holding fast to their history because they fear they have been forgotten. Old luxury and gilt banisters are their prison bars. He says the same thing. What about the slave block? Chilla was born there, not physically, but her legend, the first Memavira. He forces out this last word with an effort and a spray of intangible spittle, a wince on his face. Yeah, I didn't say it like that. She spoke to the bloom and it answered her. The monument to her strength is a murder nest now. He thinks, Memo, why is that word a struggle to recall? Yet it feels strong. Right. I want to hear about the crystal fields. A great plateau whose towers bedazzle the eye. Lightning flickers among the towers, and strange silicate beings tunnel beneath the glassy surface. There have I watched children of stars and information speak to one another through dancing colors. Have you been to any of these places? No. I stand at the tip of the tendril and watch the landscape pass by, as the great devourer prepares to latch itself onto another world. Why would I ever step outside my host? I am without danger here. Each day another piece of myself slips away. He doesn't even know if he's been to them now. Farewell. Okay. Walking without fear.
Fine.
So it took fear from him and this guy over here. Where is he? Grisler. It took both their fear. I wonder if there's a correlation.
Naturally.
There's a natural correlation? An enormous statue of a woman wielding a hammer stands here, its lower half lost to shadow in the depths of the bloom.
Why not?
Interesting.